Welcome to This Conversation with America. I'm Michael O'Loughlin, national correspondent for America Magazine. A 2002 report about the diaconate raised several questions about the role of women in the early church. In 2016, Pope Francis appointed a commission to study some of those questions. Today, I'm joined by two members of the Vatican's commission studying women deacons, Dr. Phyllis Zagano, who teaches in the religion department at Hofstra University, and Father Bernard Pottier, a member of the International Theological Commission, who teaches at the Institute of Theological Studies in Brussels. Welcome to you both. Professor Zagano and Father Pottier are speaking publicly for the first time on their research. Professor Zagano, let's start with you. You spent 4.5 months over the last couple of years living in Rome. You spent your entire career studying the role of women deacons in the church. Tell us a little bit about the last couple of years in terms of your own research, what you revisited, what stuck out to you.
Well, I had the opportunity, first of all, Michael, to live in the Holy Father's house on several occasions for two months at a time. And I had access to the Vatican Library, all the Vatican libraries, and to the Gregoriana Library as well. And as a result, I was able to see original manuscripts. I was able to see original books, 17th century books. So I basically reread everything I'd read already and actually found a few new things for myself. It was an extraordinary experience because I would go home at night, and typically in the Holy Father's house, a cardinal or a bishop or four cardinals and four bishops would be at the dinner table. So the conversations after work were equally exciting to me.
So living in this house with cardinals and bishops from all over the world coming must have provided you with an international perspective on what people were thinking about this question?
Well, you know, it did. I didn't know anybody in the house, so I would sit and not say anything. And the men would talk, and after a while, they would ask me what I was doing there, because I seemed to be there for a long time. And I told them that I was on the Pontifical Commission for the Study of Women in the Diaconate, and we would have very, very interesting conversations. I can remember at least two cardinals wanted to bring me home with them. They were very interested in the topic. Other cardinals were not that interested, and I did have a couple of complaints, mostly from Africa, that I was trying to push an American idea into Africa. I said, no one is pushing anything to anybody. First of all, I'm on a commission that's studying something at the request of the Holy Father. But secondly, as with the masculine diaconate, with the male diaconate, or with male deacons, should the church and the Holy Father say yes, it would be up to the Episcopal commissions, the Episcopal conferences, of individual nations and nation states, for example, the USCCB, to ask for women deacons, and then it would be up to an individual bishop to decide what he wanted to do in his diocese, as he does with deacons now.
And just remind our viewers, the commission itself was not studying whether to make a recommendation about if the church should or should not have women deacons. It was more about the historical reality of whether there were women deacons in the early church.
Well, absolutely, Michael. As many people have said to me, well, Phyllis, we know what you think. But but as Cardinal Ladaria said to the press last July, the commission was not charged with making a recommendation to the Holy Father. That's not what he asked for. He wants to know about the diaconate. And we studied about the diaconate, specifically about women in the diaconate. You mentioned in the top the 2002 International Theological Commission document, which was actually the second document prepared by the ITC. There was one that was prepared in 1997 that the prefect of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, at the time, Cardinal Ratzinger, refused to sign. That was a very short document. It was about 17 pages, and it basically said women deacons are no big deal. But as a result of Cardinal Ratzinger not signing that document, they asked he reformed the subcommittee of the ITC.
And the ITC being the
International Theological Commission, and the 17-page document became 74 pages in 2002.
I see.
And what it said, it was very interesting, what it said at the end was, you know, women deacons and men deacons didn't really do the same thing, that in the church's tradition, there's a distinction between the diaconate and the priesthood. And therefore, this is something for the magisterium to decide. And there it sat for 14 years until the International Union of Superiors General in May of 2016 said to the Holy Father, why don't you have a commission? Mm-hmm. And he said, that's a good idea.
So, and of course, based on those questions is how that the two of you ended up on this commission studying this question.
I guess so.
So, Father, you have spent many years, a couple decades at least, studying the question of deacons in the church. And you devote a chapter of your book to the question of women deacons. What was it that you found in your own research?
So this chapter here is, the title is From the Deaconesses of Yesterday to the Female Deaconate of Tomorrow. Mm-hmm. It's a part of a book about diaconate because after Second Vatican Council, it was a very great change about the diaconate. Mm. So before it was only a step to become a priest and even a bishop mm-hmm. who which ordained somebody deacon without the intention that that man would be a priest after, can be blamed. Mm-hmm. But now there are two kinds of deacons, male deacons. So people who are doing only a step, transitory step to priesthood. It is a kind of test during 1 year. Mm-hmm. And after, they are ordained. Mm-hmm. But now, again, in the history, again, we have deacons, ordained deacons for all their life. Mm-hmm. So it's a state of life. It's not a step. Mm-hmm. So at that second kind of deacon was in reality very common and very normal in the past. Mm-hmm. And so with with that book, I studied a lot about that new change. The new concept of diaconate, double diaconate. Mm-hmm. And because I am teaching in a seminary, so I am always with seminarians and so on, and I have to explain why the change. And also I worked for 20 years in a Portuguese parish in Brussels. Mm. Brussels, like in New York, there are many languages and so on. And there in that parish, I was working for 20 years with a community of sisters, of Portuguese sisters, of course. Mm-hmm. And I could see very clearly that the sisters, there were four or five, depends, they are working very good and very well, and more than I do because, than I did because I was teaching. Mm-hmm. And for me, it was an evidence that those women are completely able to lead the community. I don't say alone, but practically, yes, mm-hmm. they had the responsibility.
In a way that a male deacon might lead various aspects of a parish.
Yes.
You were seeing the same thing with the sisters at the parish.
Yes, a male deacon can lead a community, and mm-hmm. It's his job normally, or helping the priest doing that. But I think women deacons could do it very fine and very very good, like a deacon. And a community of sisters, not necessarily all of them deaconesses, of course, but one or two could have the responsibility and be in charge for a parish, for example, mm-hmm. that I could experience that during 20 years. Sure. So it was for me very important to understand better the history and why it was a restoration of the deaconate of the past, and why it could not be the same for the women, for example.
Great, thank you. And Professor Zagano, in your book, Women Deacons, Past, Present, Future, we know we won't get into what the commission found itself. That's a report that went to Pope Francis, and he will do what he will with it. But in your own research, your own career, your own writing, were there women deacons in the early church?
Oh, yes. You know, there's plenty of evidence of women deacons. And I think the most interesting evidence is the fact that the ordination ceremonies for women deacons were identical to the ordination ceremonies for men deacons. With changes in gender, you know, she instead
sure.
of he,
mm-hmm.
you know, but the ordinations were inside the sanctuary, inside the altar rail, at the altar by a bishop, who invoke the Holy Spirit, the epiclesis or the epiclesis, the invocation of the Holy Spirit, the giving of the stole, the giving of the chalice to the woman deacon who self-communicated. And most of all, they were called deacons. I mean, if they were not deacons, or as language developed, deaconesses, they weren't called deacons, then what were they? Mm. I mean, there's no reason to call somebody a deacon unless that person is a deacon.
And were they helping out in...
And also the laying on...
The laying on of hands.
So there was a sort of ordination component to...
Wasn't a sort of. There was an ordination.
And were these women who were ordained to the diaconate in the early church, were they helping out in liturgical functions at masses or at other sacramental ceremonies?
Yes. Well, you know, you can't say everybody did the same thing every place. Mm-hmm. But we know, for example, that Pope Gelasius complained in the 5th century that women were doing all the things that the men were doing. So they were doing it. But women deacons specifically did a lot of things that men deacons didn't do. Women deacons participated in baptisms. They anointed. They anointed ill women. They brought the communion to ill women. Pope Francis, when he spoke to the International Union of Superiors General, brought up a very interesting thing that I'd never heard about, which was that when a woman, specifically in Syria, probably in the Maronite tradition, complained that her husband was beating her, it was the woman deacon who examined the bruises and gave the testimony to the bishop. Well, to me, that's an annulment. I mean, she is providing the information and for the bishop to render a decision of nullity. So there are a lot of things that women deacons, that we know that men deacons did not do, but there are a lot of things women deacons did that we know men deacons did too. In some cases, we know women were treasurers, Anna, the treasurer of Rome. We know that women deacons in some places preached, in some places participated in liturgy. But to say that everybody did the same thing all over, I think is disingenuous, but it's true of any order. I mean, Father Pottier is a priest, but he is not a parish priest. You know, he's a professor. Mm-hmm. Others are parish priests, but they're not professors. So the fact of the order is something that we could look retrospectively and say, well, some were assigned to do this, some were assigned to do that, some were assigned to do something else.
And Father, you share that opinion that there were clearly women serving as deacons in the early church.
Yes, of course, it's evident. Yes, not everywhere, not always, etc. Because it was also a choice of the bishop. The bishop mm-hmm. appointed or not deacons, male deacons or women deacons.
Is there some evidence that some bishops chose not to appoint women as deacons?
Yes, in the first century, it was especially in the East Church. Mm. But in the West Church, it was from the 5th century on that the deaconesses began to work. And some bishops yet, of course, in the Frankish church in France, in the Gaule, was not happy with the work of the deaconesses and prohibited in their own diocese the the promotion of the deaconesses. But it's clear that it was not canonically or theologically impossible, but there... As a leader of their own dioceses, considered they didn't need that kind of service. And other admitted it.
When do we see women serving as deacons kind of phase out, stop? When does that stop? What time are we talking?
It depends. Also, it seems that in the East Church, it began very early and it stopped about... 10th century, perhaps.
Okay. So there's several centuries where women are serving
as
deacons.
Yes, a millennium in the East. In the West, on the contrary, it began later, more or less 5th century, but it stopped later too, probably 11th, 12th century. And there we have a break, very important break, not only for the diaconesses, but also for the training of the priests. and with Gregorian reform. And it was a turning point and a change tremendous in the history of the church for the best, I think so. But in certain aspects too, we have lost a tradition from coming from the past.
So one final question for Professor Zagano. You seem confident that there were women deacons in the early church. What are you hoping for in the future with this question?
That's interesting. I hope that the church will not be denied what it needs. I have often said that, and I truly believe, that the church needs more ministry. And if this is a mechanism by which the church can have more ministers, you know, I speak to bishops and cardinals from South America. One bishop said he had 5 million Catholics and 400 priests. Father Sosa from the Father General of the Jesuits told me that in Venezuela there was one parish with two priests and 14 different chapels around. The missionary sisters that I've spoken with, they say it would be so much easier in their ministry, since they are up the mountain in the chapels, to be able to do the weddings and do the baptisms, because the priest will come once a year. And if they can do the wedding and they can do the baptisms ordinarily, I mean, there are all sorts of, you can jump through hoops to do these things extraordinarily. They don't have to worry about the people going to the evangelical place next door. And that really is is what I would hope for, more ministry for our people.
Okay, so a question of ministry. Well, thank you both for joining us today. Thanks for watching us, Conversations with America. For more on this story and the topic of women deacons, visit americamag.org/women-deacons. I'm Michael O'Loughlin, national correspondent for America Magazine.
Thanks for watching our video. Please click on the subscribe button below for more insights into the world of faith, culture, and news from America Media.